10 footballers' wives and girlfriends have set up shops and are running two rival fashion outlets in London. If you missed its premiere on ITV2, don't miss the new ITV2 on ITV1. It starts tonight with Wags Boutique at 11.
Good morning. Supermarkets are preparing for a multi-million pound slump in chicken and turkey sales because of bird flu worries. We're live around Britain to see how the outbreak could affect you. Sarah Moore is in Suffolk, Richard Gaisford is in Hampshire, Jonathan Swain's in Hertfordshire.
Varicose veins, hernias and cataracts. Will your local doctors soon be carrying out simple operations under new government plans?
And the action, the glitz, the glamour, the 41st US Super Bowl has been played out overnight in Miami with a worldwide television audience of 140 million. That's all to come on Monday, the 5th of February, 2007.
Hello, good morning. You're watching the News Hour. It's just gone 6 o'clock. We'll have more on those stories in the next hour.
Also coming up, are anorexia victims being left to starve in the Twilight Zone? A new report shows that people suffering from eating disorders are being let down by doctors.
Plus, was it a foul controversy? Mars, Manchester United's 4-0 thrashing of Spurs as Ronaldo once again gets yet another penalty. More on that in a moment.
Nippy Outler?
Yes, it is nippy out, actually. Sub-zero across many places. Away from the far southeast, where it's going to be another dull day, sadly. Elsewhere, look at this, you're going to be seeing lots of sunshine. It is a very chilly start to the day, a frost in places, and we could see the odd winter shower just clip places such as Aberdeenshire, perhaps even the Yorkshire coast, just about. And through the morning into the afternoon, then we'll little change, really. And we'll always see that cloud in the southeast, Mr. Merck as well. Elsewhere, you'll see sunshine. Thanks, Penny.
Thanks very much. The poultry industry is bracing itself for a backlash this morning as scientists finish the cull of 160,000 turkeys infected with the H5N1 strain of bird flu. Japan has announced that it's stopping all poultry imports from Britain. Other countries are now expected to follow suit, but health officials insist that there is no danger to the public. Well, Sarah Moore is at the restricted zone in Suffolk. Sarah.
Yes, that's right, Penny. Good morning to you. We're just outside the police cordon. Access is very, very much restricted here. This is the 2-mile zone where all poultry has to be kept indoors and has to be tested. We've then got another area, which is a surveillance zone, which stretches 6 miles around the factory. Their poultry is very limited on the movement. But then we have another zone which DEFRA have brought in, which is a protection zone. This is a huge area. It stretches north up to Great Yarmouth and south down to Felixstowe. And people obviously here are very, very much affected by all these restrictions that are being brought into place. But the big question they want answering is how the strain of the virus got into the farm in the first place. And that's what many theories are trying to answer this morning.
The reality of life for poultry farmers close to the infected farm. Oh, yeah, Alistair Cameron's heard nothing from DEFRA officials and doesn't know how to proceed to protect his chickens.
Are these a risk at all of bird flu?
Yeah, all birds are, yes, I suppose so. But they say that it's brought in by wild birds, but I'm not that convinced that it is. Could be brought in by vehicles, you know, the virus, I don't know. But they'll have to go in tomorrow, so... I haven't got a place for them yet.
Experts believe the virus may have reached the infected farm in the droppings of wild birds, possibly seagulls, which had been spotted on the farm roof. Another suggestion is the virus may have been carried onto the farm on workers' shoes. A spokesman for Bernard Matthews has denied that the virus could have been brought from Hungary, where the company owns a local poultry producer. But it's claimed that the strain of H5N1 virus matches one identified in an outbreak in Hungary 10 days ago. DEFRA is asking the public to report any sightings at all of dead birds.
Well, the government is anxious to reassure the public that human contamination is unlikely. Pets are okay and it is safe to eat meat. But scientists say it's evidence near here that bird flu is with us and it's something that we need to learn to live with.
Sarah, thank you very much.
Let's catch up on the rest of the news. Here's Amanda.
John, thank you. Good morning. GPs should be allowed to do more to ease the pressure on hospitals and surgeons. The government's most senior advisor on GPs wants more doctors to carry out minor operations and post-operative checkups. He says it would save the NHS £1.9 billion every year. A massive shake-up of the school curriculum will be recommended today. Shakespeare and algebra will stay, but there should be more subjects that equip pupils for the outside world. The Qualifications and Curriculum Authority will also recommend joint subject teaching, such as anatomy, taught by science and PE teachers, and shorter and more frequent lessons. Tony Blair is under increasing pressure to avert possible military action against Iran. A major report from 15 organisations warns that an attack on Iran would be disastrous. He wants the Prime Minister to use his influence on President Bush to calm rising tensions.
This is at the heart of the row. Labelled as part of the Axis of Evil by George Bush, Iran continues to work on its nuclear programme. Peaceful, it claims, but the Americans believe it's a cover for developing nuclear weapons. So far, Iran has ignored calls by the United Nations to stop, and Washington has hinted at military action. But today, a broad coalition of charities, including Oxfam, political think tanks, trade unions and faith groups and the Muslim Parliament, will call on Tony Blair to intervene. They want him to pressure the US to have direct talks with Iran, warning that war would have unthinkable consequences for the world. Yesterday, a group of top American generals also added their voice to the campaign, urging negotiation, not attack.
Overcrowding is making British prisons more dangerous, that's according to the Liberal Democrats. Home Office figures show that violence in prisons increased by 600% between 1996 and 2005. The Lib Dems believe that the increase is a direct result of prison overcrowding. The prison service denies this and says levels of violence are stabilising. Doctors are failing young people with eating disorders. A disturbing new report suggests that 92% of under-25s feel they've no one to turn to for help. The charity, the Eating Disorders Association, accuses GPs of often missing anorexia and bulimia in sufferers and not treating the illnesses correctly. And we have more on that story later in the programme. Now, it's official. Today is the worst day of the year for absenteeism. The first Monday in February has been labelled National Sickie Day. The unions say it's insulting to suggest that workers aren't genuinely ill, especially in the middle of the cold and flu season. Now let's have a look at what's on the website this morning and tell us your worries about bird flu. Email us your messages for Shilpa. She's live on the sofa at 8:10 this morning. And we've ways for you to make your Valentine a day to remember. All that on GM.TV and now also on your mobile. That brings the time now to 6:07 and back at 6:30 with John and Penny.
Oh, it's only nine days till Valentine's Day. Have you bought your wife the usual?
I'm keeping it quiet. Good.
It means he hasn't done a thing
exactly.
About it at all.
Let's let's have a look at the morning papers to get me out of trouble. Daily Telegraph and others lead, of course, on the bird flu story. It's here to stay as a headline in the Telegraph. Mystery deepens over cause of Suffolk bird flu outbreak, says the Guardian. Times prefers a different story about a proposed change in the school timetable in which pupils might study one subject for a whole week, others for 10 minutes at a time. And the Independent, often going its own way, says this man fled Afghanistan in fear of his life. He asked for sanctuary here in Britain. We sent him back, and within a year, he was dead.
This is a horrible story in The Sun about a schoolboy in Hampshire wearing a hoodie top, stabbed to death after being called a chav. The Daily Express says now we let rapists and child sex offenders go free. Another scandal rocking the beleaguered Home Office. Thousands of rapists and paedophiles still on the streets under Britain's soft justice, it says. The Mail, the £243 million wage bill for 8,000 sick officers working part-time, the 1 hour a day police, and that's Johnny Wilkinson out in the town after that very interesting
famous
match. Yes, on Saturday, yeah, and also a very good match. And that's the front page of the Daily Mirror, calling Olivier Martinez, Kylie's erstwhile boyfriend, a cad because he hugged Penelope Cruz.
Now then, on to some sport. He's no stranger to allegations of diving. This morning, though, Cristiano Ronaldo is embroiled in a cheating storm yet again after winning a controversial penalty at White Hart Lane. That's the back page of the Daily Mail this morning. Ronaldo's storm and the Super Bowl. 140 million people worldwide watched it, in case you're just waking up. Indianapolis won, and they won committee. It was a wonderful touchdown. We'll just see this guy run, because he does run one.
Who is that?
I have no idea who he is. I have no idea what the rules are, even. I just know that's a good run.
And it staggers me the interest that I heard yesterday that two tickets were going for like $40,000, and you know, yeah, with touts outside, sure, the stadium.
Yeah.
They just do a lot of
Someday somebody will explain it to me. Brian, good to see you. Thanks very much indeed.
It's a bit like cricket, only less complicated.
Yeah, well, it probably is less complicated than cricket. Yes. You're probably right there.
Yeah. The time is almost 13 minutes past six. You're watching the NewsHour on GMTV. This morning's headlines. The poultry industry is bracing itself for a backlash this morning. The scientists finished the cull of 160,000 turkeys infected with the H5N1 strain of bird flu. Japan's announced that it's halting all poultry imports from Britain.
GPs should be allowed to do minor operations and post-operative checkups to take the pressure off hospitals and surgeons, according to the government's most senior GP advisor.
And it's officially National Sickie Day today, dubbed by industry bosses as the worst day in the year for absenteeism. Now, as you've been hearing, one of the government's top health officials is announcing new plans this morning to allow GPs to carry out minor operations. The plans would see family doctors performing procedures like cataracts, hernias and varicose veins. Advisers claim that the plans to create one-stop health centres would save the NHS £1.9 billion. Doctors have welcomed the proposals but say that GPs would need extra resources. Well, the man behind the changes, the government's GPs, are Dr David Colin Thommy, is that right?
Yes.
Joins us now, along with Vanessa Bourne from the Patients Association, who's in our Cardiff studio. Good morning to you both.
Morning.
So, first of all, if I can ask you, Dr. Colin Thommy. Are doctors actually trained to do these procedures, such as cataract operations?
I think that's not what I'm saying in my report. What I'm saying is GPs can do more minor operations than we're doing currently. What we'd be expecting is consultants or specially accredited doctors will come out to do these more complex surgeries. So every GP can't do this. It's where the care is going to take place. We expect care to be nearer. Instead of having to go to a distant hospital, patients can get these services much more locally. But they'll have properly accredited specialists doing this.
And they're going to have proper equipment, aren't they, as well?
Yes.
Particularly for things like cataracts, presumably.
Yes, but as you know, these cataracts can be done not in a big hospital. Mm. But we're building community hospitals. We've got some bigger primary care sort of one-stop shops. And so we'll expect more care to be done in that way.
So it's just a rolling out, really, of the one-stop shops, because you've already got those at the moment, haven't you?
We want to utilise them more and make it more widespread, this sort of service.
So if I can just come to you, Vanessa, what do you make of this?
Well, as Dr. Colin Thommy says, a lot of this is not new. It's been going on for years. What it does show is a huge variation in what GPs do because of what they want to do. And I think that's a real problem for patients, because they don't have a choice because of the geography of their GP. They have no choice in where they have to go for their GP services. And if more and more is going to be put on the GP and into primary care, I think patients are going to need a different means of accessing that and more choice in which GP they can go to.
So essentially this is a postcode lottery.
Well, I suppose what we're trying to do is, good practice is already happening. What the incentives of our contract and such as practice-based commissioning, giving GPs bigger budgets, will make it more widespread to address the very problem the Patients Association are flagging up. Because you'll always get super services scattered around the place. We want this to be more systematically available to people.
Vanessa, you've got a different system in mind, haven't you? A system like they have in France.
Well, in France, you have your own smart card and you can go sort of with more freedom to whoever you choose. There is going to be a real problem, I think, in the future with patients being grounded geographically by their local GP. If their local GP is not offering the wide range of services that somebody else is offering. And until a patient has their own smart card and not the ludicrous e-records that are now proposed, where everybody else holds the information except the patient. If the patient holds the information, they can then move around the system instead of as we have it at the moment.
And that is true, isn't it? I mean, trying to even get through to some doctor's surgeries is a problem for some people at the moment.
Yes, but that's true in any country. We've made big strides. Of course we can do better. We've made big strides. I think even the independent survey we just was carried out showed that nearly 90% of patients can now see a GP within their two working days. We want to do better than that, and we're expanding the number of GPs. The idea of patients having information, as our colleague has said, I welcome. and then people can make more choice. But you get a better health service, and there's international evidence, if your first contact is with a general practitioner rather than going to any specialist.
We have to leave it there. Dr. David Colin Tomei and Vanessa Bourne, thank you both very much for joining us this morning. Did I finally get the name right?
Yes.
After the fifth time lucky. Thank you very much.
OK, still to come here on the News Hour this morning, texters with your questions on bird flu. Dr. Hilary Jones will be here a little bit later on with the plain facts about that rather worrying virus.
Plus, your chance to win £10,000 this morning. Details coming up in the next half hour.
Welcome back to the News. Our time right now just coming up to 20 past six. So more questions than answers about the bird flu outbreak this morning. Where did it come from? Is anyone to blame? Can it be contained? Well, overnight, workers at the site of the outbreak have been completing a cull of nearly 160,000 animals. In a moment, I'll be talking to Professor Zhangu Banatvala, a virologist from the University of London. Meanwhile, many poultry farmers this morning are asking themselves whether the virus will spread and whether they'll be next. Richard Gaisford joins us now from a poultry farm at Whitchurch in Hampshire. Morning, Richard.
Yeah, good morning to you, John. I'm standing in the middle of a flock of 7,500 free-range chickens. They come into the barn overnight because that's where they feel safe and secure, and they'll go out at daylight and they'll be scratching around in the field outside. Now, these are all happy hens. They produce about 6,500 eggs a day, and of course, that is big business, not only for the poultry farmer here, Michael Fitzgerald, but for other farmers up and down the country and for everyone that relies on the poultry industry. So, Michael, the big question this morning, when you look at the headlines, you see the news, are you a worried man?
We are concerned, yes, but not overly concerned, mainly because we're reasonably confident that what is being done is what needs to be done.
Now, you knew quite quickly about this, didn't you? Not because you saw the headlines.
No, DEFRA actually texted us straight away that afternoon to tell us there was a problem, which was fabulous, and from there we then find out what else is going to happen.
Now, these are free-range hens. Does this mean that they can't go out now? What's the deal here?
At night they come in, naturally they come in, and we lock them up so that the fox doesn't get near them. And then in the morning we let them out at daylight, and they...
But the worry being that if this virus has come in airborne from another bird, that something might drop on them outside. Can you let them out now?
Yes, we can let them out, and we will continue to let them out until the government tell us that we've got to lock them up, because in order to remain free range, they've got to be let out during the day.
Well, Michael, we'll speak to you a little later. Thanks very much for your time this
morning.
You can see John this morning. We've been dipping our feet. We've got the suits on. The vehicles have been sprayed, all the precautions, just to try and keep these birds safe.
Richard, good to hear. Thanks very much indeed. Join me now, as I said, Professor Zhangu Banatvala, a virologist from the University of London. Let's address the concerns expressed by that farmer, Michael, down in Hampshire, first of all, Professor. How likely is it, you think, that this will spread?
Well, hopefully not, because we have had outbreaks in other parts of the world, in Hong Kong, in the Netherlands and elsewhere, and they have been contained by cunning. So hopefully this will result in the termination of this outbreak.
Meanwhile, there's concern expressed in at least one of the papers amongst the workers up there in Suffolk and Norfolk. They've been given Tamiflu. How effective is that?
Tamiflu is quite effective if given prophylactically, i.e. Before or on exposure. The problem with Tamiflu, of course, you can develop resistance to it. You can also give it for the treatment of flu, but it's got to be even quickly, within 24 or 48 hours, preferably within 24 hours.
So it'll help the symptoms, but not necessarily attack the infection itself.
Well, it will attack the infection. It will shorten the symptoms and hopefully reduce mortality, but we're nowhere near that. We're talking about pandemic flu. That's not going to start in Suffolk or in this part of the world at all. Pandemic flu, if it does take off, is going to start in the Far East or in Africa, where man and fowl live very closely together. You go to these markets and you bring back birds, some of whom may be sick. Some birds live, in fact, in the same household, and if they're sick, then that's how infection is transmitted. So almost everybody who has acquired the nasty flu of the human variety has been in contact with these birds.
And we have had an outbreak in 1918, I think.
Yes, indeed.
Go on, sorry.
Yes, 1918 was a nasty one. And there are certain similarities between what's going on now with the virus in 1918. That is why we're taking care, in fact, to monitor this virus very closely, to look at its characteristics and to have plans for containment should it occur in humans.
And should it occur in humans, it's a very, very small risk.
Yes.
We've got a serious problem on our hands.
Then I think we've got to work hard. We've got to get more doses of Tamiflu and other drugs. There is another drug which can be used. We've got to work fast on the vaccines. We've got to put, in fact, measures, in fact, to ensure that the virus spreads in a limited way. But that's all very far down the line, in fact.
And a very, we hope, unlikely prospect, one we should be aware of.
Well, not for the moment.
Yeah. Professor, thanks very much for being with us. Are you concerned about this? Dr. Hillary will be here with his take on it a little bit later on. Text us your questions to put to him on 81189 or email us at gm.tv.
Time is almost 25 minutes past six. Time to get away from it all now. Nick Dixon has been taking a look around Portugal's Algarve for us. He begins his trip in Faro.
For more than 40 years, Faro has been little more than a gateway to the Portuguese Algarve for millions of holidaymakers, most of them from the UK.
And with a coastline stretching 100 miles and brimming with top-class hotels, restaurants and sports complexes, it's easy to see the attraction. Faro itself is also worth a closer look. A must-see for sightseers is the old town, found behind an 18th century gate and still enclosed by the remains of the city's medieval walls.
Probably Faro's most famous attraction, or should that be infamous attraction, is this Capela dos Ossos, a chapel which is decorated here on the walls with the bones of more than 1,000 monks.
There's also plenty for serious shopaholics in Faro, whether you're hunting out souvenirs or planning some serious retail therapy. The most popular resorts in the Algarve lie west of Faro, but just half an hour in the other direction, you'll find something rather different. Tavira is one of the most photogenic towns in Portugal, with a slower, more chilled pace of life. The town dates back to around 2000 BC, and despite a devastating earthquake in 1755, Tavira still boasts the remains of a Moorish castle with splendid views. There's also over 30 churches, as well as a former convent that's taken on a new lease of life.
It's a real mix of the very new and the very old here, because amazingly, beneath this beautiful hotel lies the ruins of a 10th century settlement. Take a look.
If you do fancy a dip or just hitting the beach, you'll need to jump on a ferry and take a short ride.
And once you get here, you'll realise why it was worth that extra little bit of effort. The beaches are gorgeous, not too crowded, and the water is just perfect. Fancy a swim?
We travelled to Portugal with Cosmos. Flights to Faro start at about £79 return, and a night at the Convento de Graça Pousada in Tavira will cost around £65 per room for bed and breakfast. Prices will vary depending on when you go. Other tour operators include Direct Line Holidays, Portland and My Travel.
Yeah, I do quite fancy a swim. Not in the coast of Britain at the moment, but chilly.
Indeed. Lots more still to come. First, let's get the exact nature of the weather from Claire.
GMTV Weather, sponsored by Nestlé Shredded Wheat. Shredded wheat and hot milk, they're a perfect winter warm-up.
Hello, good morning. Most of us enjoyed a lovely weekend of sunshine. Down towards the southeast, though, the fog was stubborn through Sunday in particular. And today we're seeing a lot of low cloud and also some fog patches, particularly across East Anglia. Elsewhere, as you can see, the cloud has been mostly broken, and that means temperatures have fallen overnight. So we're talking of frost, particularly across much of England and Wales and also Ireland there. To the north, there's been a little bit more in the way of cloud, and we are seeing one or two showers now sort of pepping up those sort of coastline of north and eastern areas of Scotland, down towards northeast England as well. And you can see those temperatures struggling this morning, so if you're heading out, wrap up warm. It's a bit of a breeze in the north. Let's have a look and see what's happening through the afternoon then. Well, a little change for Scotland, really. Temperatures are going to be struggling a little bit, only up to 4 or 5 degrees Celsius. Most of you, you'll see some good spells of sunshine, blue sky, and the odd wintry shower just clipping the northeast there, perhaps the Northern Isles. Heading further south, well, it's going to be a lovely day for Northern Ireland, 6 Celsius here, as well as central and southern parts of Scotland. Down towards Northern England, although again, it's the Northumberland coast, Tyne and Wear, County Down, as well as Yorkshire, where you could see just the odd shower. Most places, though, remaining dry. Wales getting away with a lovely afternoon, as well as the Midlands. And any fog patches across the East Anglia should actually clear, although we could see more clouds lingering on across the far southeast there. And just the odd chance of a shower to the north. Central southern England, seeing that clouds will come and go through the afternoon, but down to the west, towards the west country, that's where the highest temperatures are likely to be, and also the best chance of sunshine. Let's have a look down towards the Channel Isles there. You can see a lot of cloud, the odd spot or two of rain. And then tonight, well, some places likely to be colder than last night, particularly across Scotland, where it will be clear, and a bit of a breeze coming in from the northwest, particularly again across the northern half of Britain. Tuesday into Wednesday then, it really is a case of, well, sunshine and the odd shower, and then over the next few days we are expecting more cloud to come in across the west. Here's your summary. Find out what's in store for the next 5 days on our website, gm.tv.
Good morning, it's 6:30 on Monday the 5th of February.
You're watching the News Hour here on GMTV. Coming up, dying to be thin. There are new claims that the dots aren't spotting the signs of eating disorders soon enough. We'll be speaking to one young sufferer in the next half hour.
Also, taking the sickie. Today is the worst day of the year for absenteeism, apparently. Now the first Monday in February has been labelled National Sickie Day. More in a second.
First, our top story this morning, the bird flu outbreak. We're live around the country. Sarah Moore is at the farm where the outbreak started. Richard Gaisford is gauging the reaction of farmers to the virus, and he's down in Hampshire. And Jonathan Swain is looking at whether you're still happy to buy chicken and turkey at the supermarkets. He's up in Watford, I think. First, though, Japan has announced this morning that it's halting all poultry imports. Sorry, Monday morning. Poultry imports from Britain and other countries are now expected to follow suit. But health officials insist there's no danger to the public. Sarah Moore is at the restricted zone in Suffolk. Sarah.
Yeah, good morning to you, John. We're just outside the police cordon. This is a 2-mile stretch around the infected farm. We also have another area which is restricted, and that's a surveillance zone, which is a 6-mile stretch. And then another huge area which spans north up to Great Yarmouth and south down to Felixstowe. So most people in East Anglia are infected by this latest outbreak of bird flu. But most people's concern is how it got into the farm in the first place. And there's many theories about this morning trying to answer that question. Reality of life for poultry farmers close to the infected farm. Alistair Cameron hasn't heard anything from DEFRA officials and doesn't know how to proceed to protect his chickens. Are these a risk at all of bird flu?
Yeah, all birds are, yes, I suppose so. But they say that it's brought in by wild birds, but I'm not that convinced that it is. Could be brought in by vehicles, you know, the virus, I don't know. But they'll have to go in tomorrow, so I haven't got a place for them yet.
Experts believe the virus may have come from droppings of wild birds, possibly seagulls, which have been spotted on the farm roof. Another suggestion is it could have been carried onto the farm on workers' shoes. A spokesperson denied it could have been brought in from Hungary, where the company owns a local poultry producer. But it's claimed the strain of H5N1 virus matches one identified in Hungary 10 days ago. DEFRA now asking the public to report any sightings at all of dead birds. Well, the government are anxious to reassure the public that human contamination is unlikely, pets aren't at risk, and you also can't get bird flu from eating the meat. But scientists say it's a reality we now need to live with. Bird flu is very much in Britain now. It's something that we need to learn how to cope with.
Sarah, thanks very much indeed. More from our other two correspondents a little bit later in the programme.
27 minutes to 7. Let's cross to the news desk now and Amanda.
Penny, thank you. Good morning. GPs should be allowed to do more to ease the pressure on hospitals and surgeons. The government's most senior advisor on GPs wants more doctors to carry out minor operations and post-operative checkups. He says it would save the NHS £1.9 billion every year. But critics say it could lead to a postcode lottery system where patients in some areas will get better treatment than in others.
that's a real problem for patients because they don't have a choice because of the geography of their GP. They have no choice in where they have to go for their GP services. And if more and more is going to be put on the GP and into primary care, I think patients are going to need a different means of accessing that.
A massive shake-up of the school curriculum will be recommended today. Shakespeare and algebra will stay, but there should be more subjects that equip pupils for the outside world. The Qualifications and Curriculum Authority will also recommend joint subject teaching, such as anatomy taught by science and PE teachers, and shorter and more frequent lessons. Tony Blair is under increasing pressure to avert possible military action against Iran. A major report from 15 separate organisations warns that an attack on Iran would be disastrous. It warns that wants the Prime Minister to use his influence on President Bush to calm rising tensions. This is at the heart of the row. Labelled as part of the Axis of Evil by George Bush, Iran continues to work on its nuclear programme. Peaceful, it claims, but the Americans believe it's a cover for developing nuclear weapons. So far, Iran has ignored calls by the United Nations to stop, and Washington has hinted at military action. But today, a broad coalition of charities, including Oxfam, political think tanks, trade unions and faith groups and the Muslim Parliament, will call on Tony Blair to intervene. They want him to pressure the US to have direct talks with Iran, warning that war would have unthinkable consequences for the world. Yesterday, a group of top American generals also added their voice to the campaign, urging negotiation, not attack. Now, it's official. Today is the worst day of the year for absenteeism. The first Monday in February has been labelled National Sickie Day. The union say it's insulting to suggest that workers aren't genuinely ill, especially in the middle of the cold and flu season. Here's Emma Louise Johnson.
Long dark nights, post-Christmas blues, credit card bills and the wait for the next holiday are just some of the reasons why 300,000 workers may call in sick and stay in bed today, which could cost British industry £27 million.
Well, I really think the media shouldn't be going around telling people that it's National Sickie Day, you're just encouraging us all.
Companies make lots of money and they should take the pressure off their workers and just let them take a day off sick if they want it.
Professor Carrie Cooper thinks there needs to be more flexibility and honesty.
What they have, by the way, in Sweden and in Scandinavia are what they call mental health days. And you can call up and rather than saying, I've got a cold, I'm not feeling very well, and throw a sickie, they call up and say, you know, I'm a bit knackered, a bit tired, I'm a bit stressed out, I'd like to take the day off. That's all I have to say. They don't have to make an excuse.
So if you're thinking of phoning the boss, feigning an illness and crawling back under the covers, think again, because this report may just have scuppered your plans. Emma Louise Johnston, GMTV News, at work in Manchester.
That brings the time now to 6:36. Our next news update is at 7. Here's Penny and John.
Why are you here?
I don't know.
Our director had the brilliant idea to illustrate that story by taking a shot of an empty couch. Some of you may prefer, who knows? Competition time now, your chance to win 10 grand and a home entertainment system.
Richard Arnold has the details.
Giving you the chance to win £10,000 in our BAFTA competition. Yeah, that's £10,000 to spend on whatever you like. But not only that, you could also win a 42-inch high-definition ready plasma screen and recordable DVD player. If you want to be in with a chance of winning, here is the question you need to answer. Which of these is a famous film theme sung by Shirley Bassey? Is it A, Gold Toe, B, Gold Thumb, or C, Goldfinger?
You can dial 09068 100 100. Yes, that's 09068 100 100. Or you can text A, B or C as your answer, plus your full name and address to 81149. You can also enter on our website, either online or on your mobile.
Lines close at 9 and we will reveal the winner at the end of the show.
Also, for your chance to win a pair of VIP tickets to the Orange BAFTA Awards this Sunday, log on to our website, gm.tv.
Here's what's happening where you are.
Good morning and welcome to the breakfast news from ITV Granada. First, investigations are continuing into how a light aircraft crashed into the sea off Blackpool. Roy Halliwell, who was 74, and 26-year-old Andrew Walker, both from Fylde, died when a four-seater plane they'd rented ditched a few hundred metres off the promenade. Friends of the pair, who were both members of the Combed Flying Club, say they're devastated. Commuters using the Mersey ferries this morning face disruption as the service is suspended following an accident over the weekend. A ferry which collided with a cargo vessel is currently moored at Pierhead. There were no injuries among the nearly 300 passengers and crew. More than 40 vehicles were stranded on board because of the ferry listing in the water. A delegation of MPs from the Fylde coast are due to lobby the House of Lords today to see if they can reverse the decision to bring the UK's first super casino to Manchester. Blackpool had been the favourites and it would have spearheaded a multi-million pound regeneration of the resort. But an independent panel last week decided the area around the City of Manchester Stadium was more in need of the development. Liverpool fans are waiting to hear if a controversial takeover approach for the club's been accepted. American businessman George Gillette's reported to have joined forces with fellow tycoon Thomas Hicks. It comes after the Dubai consortium, which had been favourites to buy the club, pulled out last week. It's rumoured the takeover could be sealed this week. In rugby league, St Helens have made a successful start to their defence of the Super League title. The Saints made a confident start with three tries in the first 20 minutes, but were gradually pegged back by Huddersfield. The game, a rerun of last year's Challenge Cup final, eventually saw St Helens win by 18 points to 10. Finally, if you're a fan of Simply Red, then don't miss tonight's Granada Reports. Our entertainment reporter Caroline Hacking will be speaking to Manchester singer Mick Hucknall. The 46-year-old's just found out he's going to be a dad for the first time. He'll be talking about that, the band's new single and its raunchy video.
Hi, this is Mick from Simply Red, and I'll be talking with you live on Granada Reports at 6 about my new single and other things.
That's it for now. I'm back at 7:05. Time now for a look at the region's weather.
Relief for dry, chapped hands when they need it most. Nivea Hand SOS Intensive Balm.
A cold, bright start with frost in places, but sunny spells throughout the morning. This afternoon, the odd showers possible, otherwise dry with more sunny spells.
Welcome back. The time's 19 minutes to 7. You're watching the News Hour here on GMTV. The cull of thousands of turkeys continues at a Suffolk farm this morning to prevent the spread of a mass outbreak of bird flu. Health officials are reassuring the public it's only transmitted through direct contact with poultry. But is that enough to allay your fears? Well, Dr. Hillary is here to answer some of your questions in just a moment. But first, Jonathan Swain joins us now from a supermarket in Watford.
Good morning. Well, if you are shopping today or over the next few days, you may well be wondering how this latest scare affects you. Do you still carry on buying your chickens, your eggs and other poultry products? Well, the supermarkets are certainly bracing themselves for a dip in sales over the next few days. Even the British Poultry Council say that this latest scare is not good news for their industry. We'll just take a look at the shelves this morning. You can see that they are still packed with chickens, and we're here to tell you this morning that they are in fact safe to eat. All the experts say that none of the infected meats, the infected birds, have actually entered the food chain, so you're perfectly safe to eat a chicken and other eggs and poultry products that are on sale in the supermarket. But despite this, I spoke to some shoppers out and about yesterday who did, though, have their concerns.
I was concerned yesterday. I wouldn't do it now. I'd think about it twice.
Unless there's any sort of advice from the government to do otherwise, then I'll continue eating what I like eating.
I'm actually going in to go and buy some poultry now.
No, I'm still going to buy chicken. I think the authorities have got it pretty much under control, so why change?
The problem is there are too many instances as regards meat and poultry and things like that where we haven't entirely been told the truth about things and we sort of find out later. I mean, it's not a million years since BSE, is it?
They're the views of a few concerned shoppers that I spoke to yesterday. Well, supermarkets have told us that sales haven't been affected at all over the weekends. Let's just hope that continues over the next few days.
Thanks very much, Jonathan. So how concerned should you be? Dr. Hillary joins us now. The first big question, of course, posed by those people, answered in some regards by those people, is it still safe to eat poultry and eggs.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the farm where the outbreak has happened has been entirely contained. And even if you were to eat a bird that had been contaminated, which is of course not the case, it's the virus is destroyed by cooking.
So if it's
in
cooked
a
properly,
way.
Absolutely no fears.
Even if
it
the
was
bird, yeah. Now we haven't got any birds on the shelves that are contaminated anyway, so it's perfectly safe to eat chicken and poultry, turkey, whatever. Even if the bird's been contaminated by any sort of peculiar eccentricity, then it certainly wouldn't cause you any problems.
Second question: how do humans catch it?
Well, humans only catch avian flu with enormous difficulty. There have only been a very small number of cases globally in the world, and the people who've been infected have generally been in extremely close direct contact with the infected birds. They've been living under the same roof as birds, on the same floor as birds, with their droppings in the dust that they're inhaling, or actually in direct contact with the body fluids of the poultry as they slaughter them. So it's actually extremely difficult for this virus to infect humans.
And what does it take for it to spread from human to human is a third question I think a lot of people want to know.
Well, it takes mutations, it takes the combination of genetic material from the avian flu virus to an ordinary human flu virus, the meeting of the genetic material to produce a virus which contains genetic components of both, which is very virulent and very easily spread. Now, that's been theoretically possible since the last big outbreak in 1918. Hasn't happened for nearly 100 years. Some experts are saying it could happen any time, but that's been true for the last 100 years. Hasn't happened yet with millions of birds and millions of humans. Why would it happen now?
Fourth question from Amber in Leicestershire, who asks, why do these infected carcasses have to travel so far to be destroyed? Because they're going from East Anglia, aren't they, right across, I think, to Staffordshire. And people don't even, if I pass one of these vehicles on the road, am I in danger of breathing in some fumes or whatever and becoming poorly?
It's a question that a lot of people are asking. The critical word is infected birds. They're not infected birds. The way the media has reported this is 160,000 turkeys on this farm have been infected. They haven't. There are 22 sheds of poultry on that farm. Only one of them has had infected birds. Now, those birds would have been bagged and would have been isolated and destroyed very carefully with intense biosecurity. The other sheds, the birds are not infected, and it's been safe for them to be culled and transported by road elsewhere.
And I assume these are sealed containers anyway that they're travelling in.
Well, one hopes so. But, yeah. But I mean, clearly, if the birds aren't infected, the biosecurity measures can be on a lower level. But one hopes that scientists have been working on the potential outbreak in a poultry farm for many years. So the industry, the British Poultry Council, the farmers and DEFRA and the government together should by now have very tight biosecurity in place to keep this contained and stop it spreading elsewhere.
I think the word is this morning, Hillary, for the time being at least, relax, folks.
Absolutely.
Nevertheless, if you have a question for Dr. Hillary about bird flu, you can email us or text us on 81189. There's also more advice on the website, gm.tv, online. And now on your mobile, just text the word mobile to 81189 and follow the instructions. Thanks, Hillary.
Pleasure.
It's 14 minutes to 7. You're watching the News Hour on GMTV. This morning's other headlines: GPs should be allowed to do minor operations and post-operative checkups to take the pressure off hospitals and surgeons. That's according to the government's most senior GP advisor.
A massive shake-up of the school curriculum will be recommended today. Shakespeare and algebra will stay, but there'll be more subjects that equip pupils for the outside world.
And it's officially National Sickie Day today, dubbed by industry bosses as the worst day in the year for absenteeism. Now, a million people in Britain suffer from eating-related disorders. This morning, there's some worrying news about how the victims of conditions like anorexia and bulimia are being treated. It's claimed that in many cases, doctors wrongly diagnose the conditions or sometimes offer the wrong type of treatment. Well, with me is 15-year-old Samantha Crilly, who's recovering from anorexia. She's here with her mum, Lynn, and her twin sister, Charlotte. And Mark Riley, I presume that's the way you pronounce it? Good, from the Eating Disorders Association, which is from today known as Beat. Good morning to you all. Samantha, what happened to you?
Well, basically, it was sort of over Christmas. I was really ill and
this is
I had
a while
the flu.
Ago.
Yeah, a while ago I had the flu and basically I lost a lot of weight. And I sort of, as a young child, I wasn't fat, I just had puppy fat sort of thing. And basically I was ill and I lost a lot of weight and sort of people commented on how good I looked. And basically I sort of, I didn't eat much obviously over that period, and I just sort of thought that if I didn't eat I would just carry on losing weight, and it just got out of control out there really.
And when you say it got out of control, I think at your worst you were you weighed 5 stone, is that right?
5 stone 6, I think.
5 stone, yeah. 6 pounds. Yeah. Obviously desperately thin. Yeah. And meanwhile, you must have been very worried. Twin sister?
Yes, very worried. I mean, it's very difficult to see your sister going through that. But
and what did you say to her?
I didn't really know, like, what the eating disorder was about, obviously, like, because I was quite young at the time. But
you, I think you were 12, weren't you?
Yeah, we were 12. Yeah. But I tried to sort of encourage her and believe in herself more and sort of try and get over it.
I think you found it quite hard to understand.
Yeah, at first I found it quite hard to understand, but as it went on...
Why you would do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it is difficult to understand, isn't it, Mum, why somebody would do that sort of thing? Why you would carry on to that extent, I suppose, I'm saying. I know I can understand why, because we all have been undiagnosed.
I think from what I've learned, I think once the body gets down to a certain body weight, the anorexia kicks in, and then it's not the actual sufferer that you're dealing with, it's the disease within them.
And you recognised the symptoms, didn't you?
I did. I recognised them before anyone else. There were certain symptoms. I noticed that she was on and off the scales. She had lost a dramatic amount of weight within about 4 months. She was becoming more and more withdrawn. She'd lost all concentration with her art and her school stuff. And she just seemed to be becoming really introvert.
Mark, the report seems to say that GPs misdiagnose this or don't even or don't give any help.
Mm. It's difficult for GPs. I think people are reluctant to come forward because of the shame and stigma around the disorders. Mm. And what this week's all about for us is encouraging people to make that first step, to talk to their GP, to talk to their family. Because, I mean, in your case, the GP was very supportive, wasn't he?
Oh, he was fantastic, yes. He really did listen to me. I tried several angles of the services. And every time when I wasn't happy or their therapist didn't suit us, I would go back to him and say, you know, look, this isn't working, can we try something else?
But then this obviously isn't 100%, is it, with doctors?
Some doctors don't pick up on the problems early enough, there's room for improvement. But doctors have a hard job. They can't be experts in every condition. But we would like to see people with eating disorders, we'd like to see the problem picked up on quickly and doctors acting.
And Lynn, what worked with you in the end?
In the end, I decided to go and train and learn all about eating disorders. I've read every book. I went to the Eating Disorder Association. I've gained several diplomas. I went to my GP. I went to the girls' school, who I have to say were extremely supportive, and with a unit of very close friends and my family and, of course, our husband. I mean, it hasn't been easy, but... You've only got to look at Sam to see how good she looks.
Yes, fantastic. And now you're sort of, I think you're seven stone, is that right?
Yeah, like 7'13".
Yeah. 7'13". Yeah. Yeah. Oh, perfect. So
doing very well.
So that's not going to happen again.
We won't be going back there.
Well, thank you very much for coming in and telling us your story. Thank you all.
Yeah, well done to you all, especially Mum. Did a lot of homework there. Just a quick look at one of the stories in the papers this morning, which I'll show you because I know Penny would love to as well. It's this morning's picture. This poor little dog has been born without ears. That's strange.
It does look a bit odd, doesn't it, really?
However, there is hope. They think that it can actually hear things. It's where its ears should be is just completely sealed over with skin and fur. They think it can actually hear things, and they're contemplating making two little sort of holes in there.
Yeah. Makes them easier to wear a hat.
Exactly, yeah.
Without his ears getting in the way. Now, that's it from John and me on the News Hour.
Yes, coming up on GMTV today, it's Fiona and Andrew. They'll be giving you another chance to win 10 grand and the home entertainment system.
And also coming up, the first live television interview with Celebrity Big Brother star Shilpa Shetty. But first, the weather with Claire.
GMTV weather, sponsored by Nestlé Shredded Wheat. Shredded wheat and hot milk, they're a perfect winter warm-up.
Hello, good morning. Most of us saw a lovely weekend away from some parts of London and the southeast where the fog lingered on. And this morning you can see some patchy clouds to the north, and that's where temperatures are just about held up. Clear skies across this central zone here, and here temperatures have dipped below freezing. We're seeing more in the way of cloud down towards the southeast. One or two showers across the far north as well, and in fact they could be falling as snow, particularly over around 200 metres. So this morning it's a chilly start wherever you are, and we can see here a frost on the cards, particularly across Ireland as well as Wales, northern England, down towards the Midlands there, perhaps even the West Country, but to the southeast, that's where temperatures were just about held up overnight, where more than aware of clouds. You can see though most of us will be seeing some sunshine as we head through the morning. So through the afternoon then, well, a little change for Scotland really. For the far north, we could see again the odd wintry shower, but generally it's going to be dry with sunny spells. 4 degrees Celsius, only 39 Fahrenheit. It's going to be a bit of a chilly day. A chilly day for Northern Ireland as well, but at least you're seeing sunshine, blue sky, Isle of Man, a similar situation. This eastern side of Scotland and England always seeing perhaps the odd shower, more in the way of cloud, and they could actually turn out to be a little bit wintry, but northwest England seeing gorgeous blue sky, sunshine today. As well as if I step out the way, you can see anywhere from Pembrokeshire up towards Gwynedd, seeing some lovely weather. Midlands also doing very well. We can see the odd shower across Norfolk, perhaps, and the cloud quite stubborn through the afternoon down towards the southeast, but it tends to break up on its northern edge. For the West Country then, temperatures 7 to 9 degrees Celsius. It'll be fine and dry and sunny here. Hanging on to more cloud, particularly down towards the Channel Islands. But then overnight tonight, it's going to be another cold night. It could be colder across Scotland with the clearing skies. A bit more of a breeze coming in from a cold direction. And that means as we head into Tuesday, it's going to be a chilly start to the day. Again, the odd wintry shower, particularly across this eastern side here. Most of us seeing some sunshine, though. And then all change as we head Wednesday into Thursday. Cloud and rain coming in. And there's a small possibility at the moment. It could turn to snow on its northern edge. Here's your summary. For your local five-day weather update, visit our website, gm.tv.
Good morning. Bird flu confusion, as chickens roam free on a farm near the bird flu outbreak, is enough being done to prevent the spread of the disease.
Supermarkets slump. Shops say their worried fears over bird flu will cost them dear. As the story unfolds, we're live around the UK to see how the breakout could affect you. Sarah Moore's in Suffolk, Richard Gaysford's in Hampshire, Jonathan Swain in Hertfordshire. All that to come.
As well as that, Shilpa speaks. The Bollywood star gives us her first live television interview after winning Celebrity Big Brother and all the shenanigans that went with it. That's all to come. It is Monday, the 5th of February. It's 2007. A very good morning to you and a happy start of the week, we hope. You're watching GMTV today. Almost 7 o'clock is the time.
Except if you're a chicken, it's not a very happy start to the week, is it? No, exactly. Shilpa will be here in just over an hour to tell us what really went on in the Big Brother house and how she really feels about Jade, Joe and Daniel and how she really feels about possibly doing a film with Hugh Grant.
And do you think she'll really tell you what she really feels?
Really not, probably.
Okay, 8:10 for that. Also this morning, we're meeting the first of our couples, hoping to tie the knot all over again on St. Valentine's Day.
We had a couple of deaths in the family literally 2 weeks before the wedding. And so it was like a roller coaster ride to the wedding. Yeah. I think we'd pinned all our hopes on it, and then it fell apart at the seams.
They're one of our contestants, aren't they?
February the 14th, we're giving somebody the chance to be involved in a second time around.
And we have a brand new competition, no second time around for this, £10,000 and a home entertainment system to win.
A new one. OK, first this morning, though, the poultry industry is bracing itself for a backlash after scientists finished the cull of these 160,000 turkeys infected with the H5N1 strain of bird flu. Japan has announced it's halting all poultry imports from Britain.
Other countries are now expected to follow suit, but health officials insist there is no danger to the public. Sarah Moore is at the restricted zone in Suffolk. Morning, Sarah.
Morning, Fiona. Yes, the concern over what will actually happen to the poultry industry is what's concerning most people here. People in Holton, the neighbouring villages, they all rely heavily on the poultry industry. You can see behind me as the sun rises, the factory. That's where the culling of the birds is taking place. The cleanup will start later today. And then this is a restricted zone. The police are still out. It's a 2-mile restriction zone. The cordon goes right around the area of the factory. Inside there, the birds are all kept indoors and have to be tested. There's another exclusion zone, a 6-mile zone. That's a surveillance zone, and then a further protection zone which stretches north up to Great Yarmouth and south down to Felixstowe. So people throughout East Anglia are very much affected by this, and they all want to know how the strain of the virus got into the farm in the first place. There's many theories out this morning, all trying to answer that question. quality of life for poultry farmers close to the infected farm. Alistair Cameron hasn't heard anything from DEFRA officials and doesn't know how to proceed to protect his chickens. Are these a risk at all of bird flu?
Yeah, all birds are, yes, I suppose so. But they say that it's brought in by wild birds, but I'm not that convinced that it is. Could be brought in by vehicles, you know, the virus, I don't know. But they'll have to go in tomorrow, so I haven't got a place for them yet.
Experts believe the virus may have come from droppings of wild birds, possibly seagulls, which have been spotted on the farm roof. Another suggestion is it could have been carried onto the farm on workers' shoes. A spokesperson denied it could have been brought in from Hungary, where the company owns a local poultry producer. But it's claimed the strain of H5N1 virus matches one identified in Hungary 10 days ago. DEFRA are now asking the public to report any sightings at all of dead birds. The government were anxious to reassure members of the public that human contamination is very unlikely and pets are also not a risk. But scientists say it's a reality that we now need to learn how to cope with. Police cordons are up showing that bird flu is very much present right here. And scientists say we need to learn to live with the fact that it's on our doorstep.
All right, Sarah, thanks very much indeed. More on that at 7:10. First, though, here's the rest of the news with Penny.
Thanks very much. Good morning. GPs should be allowed to do more to take the pressure off hospitals and surgeons, according to the government's most senior GP advisor. He's recommending a huge shake-up of doctors' surgeries to save the NHS £1.9 billion a year. Michelle Morrison reports.
By 2010, visiting the doctor could be a very different experience. If proposals by the government's senior GP advisor go ahead, family doctors will take on basic roles traditionally carried out in hospitals. More GPs will carry out minor operations like removing varicose veins. They take over post-surgery checkups from hospital consultants, and one-stop health centres would open where patients could access GPs and consultants on the same site. It's all to take pressure off hospitals and to save money.
You get a better health service, and there's international evidence, if your first contact is with a general practitioner rather than going to any specialist.
Skeptics, though, say the proposals could mean patients in some areas will miss out.
There is going to be a real problem, I think, in the future with patients being grounded geographically by their local GP, if their local GP is not offering the wide range of services that somebody else is offering.
So far, many doctors have welcomed the plans, but say they'll need more resources.
The Prime Minister is under increasing pressure to try to avert possible military action against Iran. A major report from 15 organisations, including charities, political think tanks and faith groups, warn that an attack on Iran would be disastrous for the world. It wants Tony Blair to use his influence on President Bush to try to defuse the tension. A massive shake-up of the school curriculum will be recommended today. The report says Shakespeare and algebra should stay, but there should be more subjects that equip pupils for the outside world. The Qualifications and Curriculum Authority will also recommend joint subject teaching, such as anatomy taught by science and PE teachers, and shorter, more frequent lessons. Overcrowding is making British prisons more dangerous, according to the Liberal Democrats. Violence in prisons increased by 600% in the 9 years to 2005. The Liberal Democrats believe that it's a direct result of prison overcrowding. The prison service denies this and says levels of violence are stabilising. Doctors are failing young people with eating disorders. 92% of under-25s feel they have no one to turn to for help. The charity Eating Disorders Association says GPs often miss anorexia and bulimia in sufferers and don't treat the illnesses correctly. Actor Daniel Craig has picked up his first award for playing James Bond in Casino Royale. He was nominated for Best Actor at the Evening Standard British Film Awards and is looking to boost his chances of winning a BAFTA next week when he's up against veteran actor Peter O'Toole and heartthrob Leonardo DiCaprio. Now, it's official. Today is the worst day of the year for absenteeism. The first Monday in February has been labelled National Sickie Day, but unions say it's insulting to suggest that workers aren't genuinely ill, especially in the middle of the cold and flu season. So, have a quick look at what's on the website this morning. Tell us your worries about bird flu and email us your messages for Shilpa, who's live on the sofa at 8:10. And we've ways for you to make Valentine's a day to remember. All that on gm.tv and now on your mobile. 7:06. I'm back at 7:30. Here's what's happening where you are.
Good morning and welcome to the breakfast news from ITV Granada. First, investigations are continuing into how a light aircraft crashed into the sea off Blackpool. Roy Hallowell, who was 74, and 26-year-old Andrew Walker, both from the Fylde, died when a four-seater plane they'd rented ditched a few hundred metres off the promenade. Friends of the pair, who were both members of the Combed Flying Club, say they're devastated. Commuters using the Mersey ferries this morning face disruption as the service is suspended following an accident over the weekend. A ferry which collided with a cargo vessel is currently moored at Pier Head. There were no injuries among the nearly 300 passengers and crew. More than 40 vehicles were stranded on board because of the ferry listing in the water. A delegation of MPs from the Fylde coast are due to lobby the House of Lords today to see if they can reverse the decision to bring the UK's first super casino to Manchester. Blackpool had been the favourites and it would have spearheaded a multi-million pound regeneration of the resort. But an independent panel last week decided the area around the city of Manchester Stadium was more in need of the development. Liverpool fans are waiting to hear if a controversial takeover approach for the club's been accepted. American businessman George Gillette's reported to have joined forces with Thomas Hicks. It comes after the Dubai consortium, which had been favourites to buy the club, pulled out last week. It's rumoured the takeover could be sealed this week. On to sport, and in rugby league, St Helens made a successful start to their defence of the Super League title. The Saints made a confident start with three tries in the first 20 minutes, but were gradually pegged back by Huddersfield. The game, a rerun of last year's Challenge Cup final, eventually saw St Helens win by 18 points to 10. Finally, if you're a fan of Simply Red, then don't miss tonight's Granada Reports. Our entertainment reporter Caroline Hacking will be speaking to Manchester singer Mick Hucknall. The 46-year-old's just found out he's going to be a dad for the first time. He'll be talking about that, the band's new single and its raunchy video.
Hi, this is Mick from Simply Red and I'll be talking with you live on Granada Reports at 6 about my new single and other things.
That's it. I'm back at 8:05. Time now for a look at the region's weather.
Relief for dry, chapped hands when they need it most. Nivea Hand SOS Intensive Balm.
A cold, bright start with frost in places, but there will be sunny spells throughout the morning. This afternoon, the odd light showers possible, otherwise dry with more sunny spells.
Seven is the time. It's a Monday morning. Now, the cull of thousands of turkeys on that farm in Suffolk will hopefully be completed this morning, but the work in tracking down the source of this deadly H5N1 strain of bird flu may take a little bit longer. In a moment, we'll be talking about this and all the matters associated with it to the Environment Minister, Ben Bradshaw. Morning to you, Ben.
Morning.
First, Richard Gaisford joins us from Hampshire. We'll say very good morning to you. What's the latest from there?
Well, I'm on a farm here, Andrew, where they've got 7,500 free-range hens. They're all here in the barn. That's where they come overnight because they're safe and secure and they're happy. And in about half an hour's time, when the sun comes up, they'll go outside and they'll have a scratch around. Now, these are happy hens. They give about 6,500 eggs every day. So it's big business not only for the farmer, but also for the catering trade and the retailers, everyone that relies on the poultry farms. Michael Fitzgerald is the farmer here. Good morning. Thanks for having us along, Michael. I mean, you must be a very worried man at the moment because we're not sure about this, where it's coming from and what it's going to do.
We are obviously concerned and sincerely hope that the problem can be contained where it is in Suffolk.
Now, you knew before we did, in a way, before the headlines, because you got some information, didn't you? How did that arrive with you?
DEFRA texted us on our phone first thing that day to tell us that there was a problem. So, and from that, we then move forward.
Now, so you know there's a problem and you've got a free-range flock. Now, my concern would be putting them outside. You want them to be outside, but it's not as safe, is it?
Well, ideally, the birds have to go out because they're free-range. If the problem spreads, then the government will determine when we have to keep them in and stop them going out. But until the government tell us, they will continue to go outside.
So you will be tuned in completely to what's being said to you on that front?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, thanks for having us along this morning.
Not
and
at all.
As you can see, Andrew, we're fully togged up here this morning. We've had the vehicles sprayed down, we've had our boots dipped, and our clothing protected just to try and keep these hens as healthy as they possibly can be.
Yep, all precautions taken, Dana. Thank you very much indeed for that, Richard. Ben Bradshaw is the Environment Minister. I'm sure it's been a busy weekend with a busy week ahead. How worried are you? I mean, for instance, are there infected birds in the food chain now, Ben?
No, and this is a bird disease. Well, because the birds on this particular farm didn't go anywhere. They were eight-week-old turkeys. They mature at 21 weeks, so they'd been there a while. It's a recent infection, and no birds had been moved on and off.
Yeah, and yet, on Tuesday, birds began falling ill, and it wasn't until Thursday that restrictions were put in place. So there was a couple of days where bird flu that is killing birds was present, and nothing was actually done about it.
Well, that's not true that nothing was done. There were a small number of birds that died on Tuesday and on Wednesday, but nothing unusual. In a flock of this size, you do get birds dying in those sorts of numbers. It wasn't until Thursday, where more than 800 birds died, that the Bird and Matthews vet quite rightly informed the local state veterinary service, and we immediately put restrictions on that farm. So this idea that there was some delay is simply wrong.
But this was a closed unit, isn't it? This was 160,000 birds or somewhere around there. You know, it's closed. No wild birds, which is considered still the most likely source of this infection, no wild birds should be able to infect what is a closed flock.
Well, the source of the infection is still a mystery, and that's why we're undertaking a detailed epidemiological survey into why it might have happened. And there are a number of theories out there, but I think the priority at the moment has to be to contain and eradicate the disease in that locality to get the remaining birds killed humanely so that we don't see any spread.
I mean, you must be just waiting for the next bit of bad news now from somewhere else, presumably. If you can't identify the source, probably a wild bird, so according to the expert, it's going to turn up somewhere else, isn't it?
Well, we have been planning for this for quite some time. This virus has been around for several years in Asia. It moved to Europe last year, if you remember. People were getting very worried as the cold weather was pushing it westwards. We are a little bit surprised that it's come here now at this time when the nearest infection is Hungary, which is quite a long way away, and that's why we're not really ruling out any particular source for this infection.
Consumer confidence is going to be hit. The poultry industry is going to be hit hard. That's, you know, totally understandable. It's happened before when there's been infection. What about the guys and the men and women who were working at the Bernard Matthews facility there in Holton in Suffolk? What about the ones who were that close to the birds? Are we worried that they could be infected now?
Well, let me address consumer confidence first, because actually when we had the scare last year in Celadike in Scotland, there was a very small dip in poultry consumption in this country, but then it came back up, and actually the British consumers have proved themselves to be much more sensible and less hysterical than some in other countries, because they know there's absolutely no risk from eating poultry products. As for the workers, we don't think that they will have been under any particular risk. It's extremely difficult to catch this virus from poultry. You have to live and work in very close proximity with a lot of diseased poultry. A relatively few number of people, even in Asia, where it's been around for years and is endemic, have caught it. But all of those workers at Bernard Matthews have been offered Tamiflu prophylactically. They're all being monitored. They've all been seen by doctors. And every measure is being taken by the Health Protection Agency to make sure that the workers now involved in the culling are also kept safe.
Yeah, there's been enough of a run-up to this, hasn't there? Let's face it. Ben, thanks for joining us this morning. More on the medical implications of this bird flu arriving on our shores a little bit later on with Dr. Hillary. Email us your thoughts, gm.tv, 81189 on the text. OK.
Funny, you don't hear a word for ages and then it comes along prophylactically. We've heard about it three times this morning.
Yeah, so that's not a jab, let's just put it that way.
No, it's preventative measures.
Yes, that's it. We can't say exactly, but we know what they mean.
All right, let's check the headlines. Quarter past seven. As you've just heard, the poultry industry is bracing itself for a backlash this morning as scientists finish the cull of 160,000 turkeys on a farm in Suffolk. Japan has announced that it's halting all poultry imports from Britain. GPs should be allowed to do minor operations to take the pressure off hospitals and surgeons. That's according to the government's most senior GP advisor. And the weather cold today for the north, fog in the Midlands, rain in the east and southeast. The west, by the way, will have the best of the sunshine with temperatures around 7 degrees Celsius today. Not so warm.
£10,000 we'd like to give you, and a home entertainment system, brand new, not once used, yours. So we've got a BAFTA competition this morning.
Yes, wait till you see Richard Arnold. He's in his element, being a lovey.
Good morning, chaps. Richard Arnold here, kicking off GMTV's countdown to the BAFTA ceremony in good old London town this weekend, which is clearly why I'm dressed as one of the nominees. Borat. That's something not everyone can wear. Actually, I'm cutting a dash as James Bond, because believe it or not, Daniel Craig is the first ever Bond to be nominated for a British Oscar. Anything to do with his acting, or do we think it's got a little bit more to do with this? When you see something like that, it makes you wonder why the British Academy have sensationally snubbed me again this year, doesn't it? I mean, clearly Daniel and I have so much in common. Anyway, you could be going for gold at home today if you get your hands on today's prize. GMTV is giving you the chance to win £10,000 in our BAFTA competition. Yeah, that's £10,000 to spend on whatever you like. But not only that, you could also win a 42-inch high-definition ready plasma screen and recordable DVD player. If you want to be in with a chance of winning, here is the question you need to answer. Which of these is a famous film theme sung by Shirley Bassey? Is it A, Gold Toe, B, Gold Thumb, or C, Goldfinger?
You can dial 09068 100 100. Yes, that's 09068 100 100. Or you can text A, B or C as your answer, plus your full name and address to 81149. You can also enter on our website, either online or on your mobile.
Come on, what have you got to lose? Get on the old dog and bone. You can be £10,000 richer by the end of the show. Now, the British Academy of Film and Television Arts may have, or shall we say, overlooked me this year, but I reckon I've still got what it takes to pack a punch at MI6. What do you say, boys?
There was no need for that, was there, really?
That would put the frighteners on our defence establishment, won't it?
You've got until 9 o'clock to enter, and Lorraine will reveal the winner, apparently.
And your chance to win a pair of VIP tickets to the Orange BAFTA Awards this Sunday. That's what we're offering. Log on to our website, gm.tv, for that.
Sunday? That's come around quickly.
I know, can't believe it. It's February already. Shilpa Shetty at 8:10. Looking forward to seeing what she's got to say. It's been a massive story, hasn't it, over the last, few weeks, I suppose.
Yeah.
But Shilpa at 8:10.
She's meeting the Queen, Tony Blair, film lined up with Hugh Grant. Is it all true? We should ask her when she comes in. After the break, though, Nick Dixon takes us on a guided tour of the Algarve. He'll be finding something for everyone, apparently.
And if you've ever thought of living abroad, the latest research shows one in five of us will have retired overseas by the year 2015.
I'll be dead by then.
You'll certainly be abroad. Here's property guru Eleanor Davis with more on this.
£2.2 million Brits now own a holiday home abroad. And latest research shows that value for money property prices are the biggest incentive. Chuck in a beautiful beach with a spot of sunshine, and what can go wrong? Well, nothing if you do your research. First, be totally clear about all costs, because one in three of you who own a property overseas don't actually live there, which means you're counting on rental income. Be sure you can keep up with the monthly repayments, especially if the rental income does not live up to your expectations. Secondly, never ever purchase any property without seeing it in the flesh. Inspection trips are often heavily subsidised by the developers, so don't be afraid to ask. Also, buying rules for non-nationals vary from country to country, so you must get a good multilingual lawyer who can cut through the jargon. Your lawyer must have no ties with local estate agents or developers, therefore be totally independent.
Dreaming of a home in the sun? It can be easy. Barclays sponsors of Property Abroad.
Now then, all this week we're giving you a look at what Portugal and southern Spain have to offer. Very good looking men, if Jose Mourinho is anything to go by.
Yeah, so we sent Nick Dixon down there. He's our guide. He starts his trip in Faro, where most visitors begin their journey on the Algarve. Enjoy.
For more than 40 years, Faro has been little more than a gateway to the Portuguese Algarve for millions of holidaymakers, most of them from the UK.
And with a coastline stretching 100 miles and brimming with top-class hotels, restaurants and sports complexes, it's easy to see the attraction. Faro itself is also worth a closer look. A must-see for sightseers is the Old Town, found behind an 18th century gate and still enclosed by the remains of the city's medieval walls. Probably Faro's most famous attraction, or should that be infamous attraction, is this Capella dos Ossos, a chapel which is decorated here on the walls with the bones of more than 1,000 monks. There's also plenty for serious shopaholics in Faro, whether you're hunting out souvenirs or planning some serious retail therapy. The most popular resorts in the Algarve lie west of Faro, but just half an hour in the other direction, you'll find something rather different. Tavira is one of the most photogenic towns in Portugal, with a slower, more chilled pace of life. The town dates back to around 2000 BC, and despite a devastating earthquake in 1755, Tavira still boasts the remains of a Moorish castle with splendid views. There's also over 30 churches, as well as a former convent that's taken on a new lease of life.
It's a real mix of the very new and the very old here, because amazingly, beneath this beautiful hotel lies the ruins of a 10th century settlement. Take a look.
If you do fancy a dip or just hitting the beach, you'll need to jump on a ferry and take a short ride.
And once you get here, you'll realise why it was worth that extra little bit of effort. The beaches are gorgeous, not too crowded, and the water is just perfect. Fancy a swim?
We travelled to Portugal with Cosmos. Flights to Faro start at about £79 return, and a night at the Convento de Graça Pousada in Tavira will cost around £65 per room for bed and breakfast. Prices will vary depending on when you go. Other tour operators include Direct Line Holidays, Portland and My Travel.
There you go, and there's more information on the website too. Now then, the Queen wants to see her, the Prime Minister wants to see her, Hollywood wants to work with her. Where she decided to toddle in this morning, Shilpa Shetty, only onto the sofa. It's her first live interview since leaving the Big Brother house, since the one with Davina. I mean,
even Gordon Brown was involved in it when he went over to India at the time. Yeah, it became exactly. A massive incident. It's the first time she's talking about it live, isn't it? She's done some recorded stuff, but this is live, 8:10.
Right, let's catch up with the news now. Nearly 7:30, here's Penny.
Thanks very much. Good morning. The poultry industry is bracing itself for a backlash this morning as scientists finish the cull of 160,000 turkeys after an outbreak of the deadly H5N1 strain of bird flu. Japan's announced that it's stopping all poultry imports from Britain. Other countries are now expected to follow suit, but health officials insist that there is no danger to the public.
The source of the infection is still a mystery, and that's why we're undertaking a detailed epidemiological survey into why it might have happened. And there are a number of theories out there, but I think the priority at the moment has to be to contain and eradicate the disease in that locality to get the remaining birds killed humanely so that we don't see any spread.
A massive shake-up of the school curriculum will be recommended today. The report says Shakespeare and algebra should stay, but there should be more subjects that equip pupils for the outside world. The Qualifications and Curriculum Authority will also recommend joint subject teaching, such as anatomy taught by science and PE teachers, and shorter, more frequent lessons. Doctors are failing young people with eating disorders, according to a new report. 92% of under-25s feel they have no one to turn to for help. The charity, the Eating Disorders Association, says 92% of under-25s feel they have no one to turn to for help, and that doctors often miss the signs of anorexia and bulimia and don't treat the illnesses correctly.
Some doctors don't pick up on the problems early enough, and there's room for improvement. But doctors have a hard job. They can't be experts in every condition. But we would like to see people with eating disorders. We'd like to see the problem picked up on quickly and doctors acting.
And finally, today is apparently the worst day of the year for absenteeism. The first Monday in February has now been labelled National Sickie Day. Unions, though, say it's insulting to suggest that workers aren't genuinely ill, especially in the middle of the cold and flu season. Here's Emma Louise Johnston.
Long dark nights, post-Christmas blues, credit card bills and the wait for the next holiday are just some of the reasons why 300,000 workers may call in sick and stay in bed today, which could cost British industry £27 million.
I really think the media shouldn't be going around telling people that it's National Sickie Day. You're just encouraging us all.
Companies make lots of money and they should take the pressure off their workers and just let them take a day off sick if they want it.
Professor Carrie Cooper thinks there needs to be more flexibility and honesty.
What they have, by the way, in Sweden and in Scandinavia are what they call mental health days. And you can call up and rather than saying, I've got a cold, I'm not feeling very well, and throw a sickie, they call up and say, you know, I'm a bit knackered, a bit tired, I'm a bit stressed out, I'd like to take the day off. That's all I have to say. They don't have to make an excuse.
So if you're thinking of phoning the boss, feigning an illness and crawling back under the covers, think again, because this report may just have scuppered your plans. Emma Louise Johnston, GMTV News, at work in Manchester.
Yeah, but she is feeling a bit fluey. 7:31, here they are.
Thank you very much indeed. We call them duvet days over here, don't we?
Nothing wrong with a duvet day, I don't think. Except, have you ever had one?
No, never. No.
I've had a hungover, sick.
And still come into work day.
Yes, exactly.
Good girl, that's the way. Do exactly. Anything for the company.
Right, let's check the weather, because it is fluey weather, which is probably why most people take the day off sick. Let's check the weather with Claire.
GMTV Weather, sponsored by Nestle Shredded Wheat. Shredded wheat and hot milk, they're a perfect winter warm-up.
Hello there. Well, the weather's not looking too bad today away from the southeast, where we're still seeing a lot of low cloud and also some fog. But generally speaking, particularly for Scotland, Northern Ireland, Northern Counties of England, eventually Wales, as well as the Midlands, you're seeing blue sky and sunshine. But look at these temperatures. It is very cold out there this morning. Sub-zero temperatures across much of England and Wales and Ireland. Temperatures just holding up just about across Scotland. A little bit more in the way of wind and cloud. But we are seeing one or two showers now clipping the far northeast of Scotland. And one or two could actually go down the sort of Northumberland coast down towards Yorkshire. So that's a picture this morning. Little change this afternoon across Scotland. What we're expecting is another day of sort of blue sky, really, and just the odd shower, wintry shower in the east. Temperatures struggling a little bit, though, 4 degrees Celsius, 39 Fahrenheit. Central and southern parts of Scotland not doing too badly at all, as well as northern counties of England, particularly in the northwest. The northeast, you could see more cloud and the odd shower. Northern Ireland doing very well indeed, 6 Celsius here. If I step out the way, you can see for the bulk of Wales, it's going to be a fine afternoon and dry. Dry weather extending right the way down to the Midlands, as well as East Anglia, although one or two showers possible across the far north. And we could see some fog patches first thing, which will eventually clear. The cloud quite reluctant to clear across this southeastern edge, but down towards the central southern part of England, as well as the West Country, that's where you'll see a lovely day full of sunshine and just some patchy cloud. Channel Islands down here, though, you could see more in the way of cloud, the odd spot or two of drizzle. And then tonight, it's going to be a frosty night wherever you are, particularly away from the far south, where I think you could just hang on to perhaps 0-1 degrees Celsius. A bit more of a strong breeze up towards the northeast. That leads us into Tuesday, Wednesday. More of the same, really, and then more cloud and rain comes in on Thursday, and that's when we're likely to see perhaps a little bit of snow on the northern edge. Here's your summary. Get a 5-day weather update for your postcode on our website, gm.tv.
Snow. That'll sort the bird flu out. Or will it, I wonder? Bird flu on our shores. Should we be worried about eating chicken, turkey or eggs? Dr. Hillary here in a moment to answer your health concerns.
And in just a little over half an hour, Shilpa Shetty with her first live television interview since leaving the Big Brother house. Let's see what she has to say. It's bound to be interesting. She's been at the centre, the very centre of this huge row. So Shilpa, just after 8.
Minutes to 8 is the time. Monday morning, the big news over the weekend was the spread of bird flu. And as health officials try to prevent it, what's this outbreak done to consumer confidence, we wonder? Well, Dr. Hillary is here to answer some of your questions in just a moment. Morning, Hillary.
Morning.
First of all, though, Jonathan Swain is at a supermarket in Watford.
Good morning. Well, if you are out shopping later on today or over the next couple of days, you may well be wondering how this latest scare affects you. Should you still go out there and buy chicken, eggs and other poultry products? Well, the supermarkets tell us that they are bracing themselves for a dip in sales over the next few days. And even the British Poultry Council say that this latest scare is certainly not good news for their industry. It is an industry that employs some 55,000 people in the UK. It's worth billions of pounds because we consume some 850 million chickens every year. When there's a similar scare in France and in Italy last year, poultry sales dipped there by a staggering 60%. But just take a look around me this morning, because the shelves here, as you can see, are still heavily stocked with chickens and other poultry products. And we're told by the experts that they are perfectly safe to eat. No infected meat has actually entered the food chain. And even if it has, as long as it's cooked properly, there is no risk to our health. But despite that, I spoke to some shoppers yesterday who did, though, have their concerns.
I was concerned yesterday. I wouldn't do it now. I'd think about it twice.
Unless there's any sort of advice from the government to do otherwise, then I'll continue eating what I like eating.
I'm actually going in to go and buy some poultry now.
No, I'm still going to buy chicken. I think the authorities have got it pretty much under control, so why change?
The problem is there are too many instances as regards meat and poultry and things like that where we haven't entirely been told the truth about things and we sort of find out later. I mean, it's not a million years since BSE, is it?
Well, the farm that's at the centre of this scare is Bernard Matthews. As you can see, that their products are still for sale on the supermarket shelves today. We're told they're perfectly safe to eat. The message is, don't panic.
Oh, is it still beautiful, though, to eat Bernard Matthews and chicken and eggs and all that sort of stuff? Dr. Hillary is here this morning. We've had lots of texts and emails, Hillary, as you may imagine. Here are some of the main questions for you. The first is the very obvious one. Is it OK to eat chicken, turkey and egg still? Yeah,
absolutely. I mean, the farm that's in question has been contained. There's an exclusion zone around it. The meat on the shelves is not connected to that particular farm. And it's perfectly safe to eat poultry of any kind. I would also say that even if you were unlucky enough to buy a chicken that had been infected, which is obviously not the case at the moment, even if you did, you'd still be safe, because when you cook it, normally the virus is killed off, so you're not at risk at all, so it's safe to eat completely.
All right, as long as you cook it properly.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The second question, Jason in Glasgow, he wants to know if people did catch the virus, there's not much chance of that, is there really,
no.
But does the government have enough vaccinations for everybody in the UK?
Right. First of all, the chances of a human picking up this avian flu are incredibly small, almost negligible. That's the first point, because it doesn't jump easily from one species to another. The second question is, do we have enough vaccinations if that nightmare scenario happened? Well, we don't have any vaccination. We have a number of drugs available, notably the main one being Tamiflu, which is a tablet, not a vaccination. And that reduces the severity and duration of a flu attack, just as it does with human flu. It doesn't actually cure it, doesn't protect you from getting it. And we don't know how effective it would be, to be honest. But we would only have a vaccine if the virus that was affecting a human population could be identified so that a particular strain could be vaccinated against. But that would take months to do.
All right, and the last question, Amber from Leicestershire, she says, why do these infected carcasses have to travel so far to be destroyed?
Well, Amber, we're talking about a lot of carcasses. Remember that of the 22 sheds that are on this particular farm in Suffolk, only one had infected birds. Now, those birds would be bagged, and the biosecurity and the destruction of those birds would be very much tighter than it would be for the uninfected chickens that still need to be culled for biosecurity reasons. So when you see them being transported, those birds actually haven't been infected.
Right, they're the ones that are ending up in Staffordshire.
Correct. I mean, they haven't been infected, so the risk of them transmitting the virus is really zero.
Right.
The ones that have been affected would be destroyed in a different way, probably on site by incineration.
All right. Well, it's given us an insight into how they're kept, seeing the footage all the time.
But I think what people need to remember is that everyone's talking this up as a future possible pandemic. Those circumstances have been present since the last big outbreak in 1918. The world has moved forward since then, and we haven't had an outbreak like this. So I think keep things in perspective. Don't panic. It's safe to eat poultry. And government ministers and scientists and doctors have been working very effectively in the last few years to make sure that we don't get transmission to humans and then the human-to-human transmission.
All right, Hillary, thank you very much indeed. And as always, there's advice on the website.
7:43 is the time. It's a Monday morning. These are the main headlines that you're waking up to. The poultry industry, as we've been hearing, is bracing itself for a backlash this morning as scientists finish the cull of 160,000 turkeys on that farm in Suffolk.